Glad you could be here. Hello. Glad you could be here tonight. Before we get started, there's a couple announcements to go over, and I don't want to forget. Number one, the Pastor Search Committee questionnaires, they would like those back at least by next week. If you have done them, if you would turn them in to where you got them from, give them to a member of the Pastor Search Committee, or you can drop those at the office. Either way, whatever it is that you want to do, if you know of someone that has them and that you gave to them, if you would let them know they are due next week, they would like to have those by next week. So again, that's the Pastor Search Committee's questionnaire. Well, thank you for coming tonight. Because you're here tonight, you get to hear the exciting announcement we just decided in church council regarding next month. Starting next month, Sunday school will be back in full force starting next Sunday. We'll start all age groups. Everybody will, all Sunday schools will be open for you to attend. Sunday night's discipleship training will not start until April the 11th. Easter's on the 4th. We're going to wait until the week after Easter to start that. But we are going to promote discipleship training throughout the month of March. And there's a lot of exciting opportunities for you to be a part of classes in discipleship training as well as your children. So we're going to be promoting that through the month of March. On Wednesday nights, starting this Wednesday, we will just have our prayer meeting at 6:30. No meal yet. The next Wednesday, we will have a meal and the business meeting at 6:30. So that's the meal and the business meeting. And then on the 17th, we will begin all age groups, RAs, GAs, mission friends, children's choir, youth, everything will be open on the 17th. So this Wednesday, just the prayer meeting. Now I don't want to say just the prayer meeting because there's not just when we pray, but that will be the only thing that night. The next week will just be the meal and the business meeting. The next week, we will be wide open for that to go. So that's exciting stuff coming forward. Also, we announced tonight, and you get to hear about tonight, we have revival coming up March the 23rd through the 20th, May the 23rd through the 26th. I'm so excited, I got my dates wrong. Brother Gene Douglas will be our speaker for that week. It will be Sunday through Wednesday. And instead of the normal worship leader, we will have a Southern Gospel Quartet leading us every night. That quartet will be the Bible Tones. So that will be every night of revival starting in May on the 23rd. So a lot of exciting stuff coming up, going to be on the calendar, and we begin to open up the calendar. But I do want to also issue this from Brother Giles, and I think it bears repeating, that next week Sunday school will be open. But if you are uncomfortable, or if you know someone that's uncomfortable, we want to make sure they feel okay not to come if they don't. Safety precautions will be taken, but we're going to come back. We're eventually going to come back. We're going to come back stronger than ever. But if people are right now still timid about coming back, we want to make sure it's okay, but we are going to come back and Sunday schools are going to be wide open. So that's a lot of exciting stuff coming up. As we now turn and turn to our prayer requests at this time, want to remember Ms. Kathy Stuckey. She'll be having some scans tomorrow on her heart, and we will be praying for her, as well as her brother, Paul Barber, who is in the hospital and is getting the treatment that he needs and doing well. So be in prayer for Ms. Kathy, for her family. I know that's a hard time. Are there other prayer requests, anyone we need to name or mention tonight? Andy Sims? Any others? Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, what a joy it is to be in your house tonight. What a great way to start our week off together as a family of Christ tonight, bonded in love, bonded in worship. God, we know there have been hard times this week, where there have been valleys that we have gone through, but you have brought us here. So let us remember that you are a God that loves us, does not forsake us, and for that we should worship you with all that we have. So may our worship bring a smile to your face tonight, Lord God. No matter who's here, what's going on, may we each individually worship you for the God that you are, that you created us, loved us, died for us, didn't turn your back on us, and are here for us each and every day. Your name is the name that deserves to be above all names. Your name is a name above cancer, above disease, above death. So there's nothing else right now we should worry about but just uplifting your name above all. God, thank you for those that have come tonight. May our worship bring an incense to your throne. God, we lift up those that we mentioned in the prayer request. God, we lift up Miss Kathy and her family. We lift up our brother Andy, Lord God, and all those that weren't mentioned tonight. May they know there's a God that loves them and a church that is praying for them. And no matter what, we will go through these things together, Lord God, and you will get us through. It may be to the other side, to heaven, but you will get us through no matter where we are, because we will be with you. We are here tonight with you. May we worship your name. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Will. Got some good old songs tonight. Nothing but the blood. There is a fountain, and there is power in the blood. So y'all will know those. Just beller them out with me. 223, Nothing But the Blood. Come on, stand with me one time.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. Oh, no other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my pardon, this I see. Nothing but the blood. The blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing can for sin atone. Nothing but the blood.
Seated, there is a fountain.
There is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's vein, and sinners plunge beneath that blood, lose all their guilt. faith I saw the stream thy flowing wounds supply. Redeeming love has been my theme and shall be till I die, and shall be till I die, and shall be till I die. Redeeming love has been my theme and shall be till I die.
Yeah, there's power in the blood.
Would you be free from your burden of sin? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would your evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood.
Come on, bass.
There is power, wonder-working power in the blood. From your passion and pride, there's power in the blood, power in the blood. Come for a cleansing to Calvary's tide. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be whiter, much whiter than snow? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Sin stains are lost in its life-giving flow. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you deserve Jesus, your King? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live daily His praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power.
Thank you, Brother Rex. Don't know if you caught it or not, but we sang songs tonight about the blood of Jesus and how it washed us white as snow. And I don't know if you caught the collar shirt that Rex was wearing tonight. White. He plans stuff like that. I don't know if you know that or not. And if you don't, I'm not going. But he does. He plans some stuff like that to go along with worship. But little things I noticed. Turn your Bibles to 1 Timothy. We're going to continue on going down 1 Timothy 4. Just a reminder where we are. Timothy, as well as the book of Titus, Paul is writing to ministers of the gospel. These are two people that he has poured into and he has loved and he has showing Timothy, this is the things that you need to look out for as the pastor of this church. And there, I'm coming back to you, but these are things I need you to be looking out for. And so the first chapter is about the charge. This is your main purpose. You're really supposed, it's all about the love you have for each other. As a minister and as a church, the aim of our charge is love. And then he breaks down positions there in chapter 2, and then he goes into the offices, but he really doesn't get into the here's what you're supposed to do as a pastor, here's what you're supposed to do as deacons. He goes into the characteristics that you're supposed to have, your heart as a leader. Here is what you're supposed to be looking for as the leaders in the church, and that matters more than just that title, than just having that position. It matters more the type of person that you are. So that being said, and we're going to go into chapter 4. And so we talked about the good positions and the good people of the church, the pastors, the overseers, and the deacons. And these are servants of the church. But there are people that are in church that aren't going to serve. They're looking to be served. They want titles such as teacher and positions in the church, but they're going to lead people astray. So Paul is warning Timothy. He showed, here's what you're looking for as you grow pastors in your church. Here's what you're looking for in the deacons of your church. But be aware of these wolves in sheep's clothing. If you have that next picture up, and we'll get to that in a second. So if you could turn to 1 Timothy 4, we're going to start. We're just going to walk through this as we've been doing, as we're going through. But it starts there in verse 1. The Spirit clearly says, in the latter times, some will abandon the faith and follow deceiving spirits, things taught by demons. There's a fancy theological term called apostasy. Apostasy, A-P-O-S-T-A-C-Y. And it refers to people walking away from their faith. Now, Methodists, United Methodists, believe in falling from grace. They believe that you have the free will to choose, and so you have the free will to be saved, and then you have the free will to not be saved. You have the free will to walk away. What Paul's warning against is there are people that join the church, and they are being deceived by others, and so they're walking away. And apostasy was a very big deal, especially to these early churches, because you have to keep in mind, a lot of them fell under Roman persecution during this day. And it was a very tight-knit community of believers. Their life was at stake a lot of times each time they met. Where their location was, what they did together, was a high-held secret among some believers. And you trusted the people of your church that they are going to remain faithful to their cause. But what do you do as a church when someone says, I no longer want to attend, and by the way, I'm going to join the Roman temple, I'm going to worship the Roman gods, I'm going to pledge my allegiance to Rome. You don't know what could happen. They could sell out the location of that early church. If it is underground and not known, they could sell out believers that are trying to meet in secret and read their scriptures and pray to God. There was a big problem of apostasy. There's still a big problem of apostasy today, and it still concerns us when people walk away from the church and they walk away from faith. Nowadays, it just becomes easy and convenient to walk away. It's just a choice. It's, oh, something good's on TV. Satan's going to attack us, not over our head, not with this forceful government. Satan's going to get us by offering what it is that we want. For those of you that remember, people started getting away from Sunday night church, not because the government cracked down on attendance, because Bonanza was on, or the good show on Sunday night was on, way before you could record it. So families began to stay at home. And that's the fight today that we have against entertainment and kids and youth and young families wanting to stay at home and enjoy sitting in front of the television versus coming up and being a part of church. They seek to be entertained. We have to offer them something genuine. We have to offer them that fellowship, that genuine love that they're going to find. Eventually, they'll get tired of the entertainment, but we have to offer them what is true. So Paul is warning about those falling away, and he's also warning about the people that you're going to invest in. Be aware of that. 2 Timothy 3, 1-5 talks about those that are going to walk away from their faith. Again, 2 Timothy 3, 1-5. And he actually gives, I think it's 18 characteristics of people that walk away from the church. But mark this, there will be terrible times in the last day. People will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boastful, proud, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, without love, unforgiving, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, or forceful, not lovers of good, treacherous, rash, conceited, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having the form of godliness but denying its power, you should have nothing to do with such people. Paul's giving that warning there in the second letter. But he's alluding to it here in this first letter. These are the type of people and the characteristics they're going to have. And we could look at that and say, wow, that's today, isn't it? We see that around a lot. But the church throughout history has always had the biggest problem with verse 5. People that have the form of godliness but denying its power. People that know about God but deny he can help in my situation, that he has control in this world. They look for other things in this world for control. They look for other reasons. We're going to talk about Gnosticism tonight again, and that has a very seductive power to those that are looking for control. But jumping on to verse 2, such teachings come through hypocritical liars whose consciousness has been seared with that of a hot iron. I don't know if you've ever been burned by a hot iron or just burned before, but what happens to that area when it gets burned? It gets scarred, it gets calloused, it gets hurt. There are people that throughout their lives, they get burned and they get hardened and their soul becomes hardened and they care just about themselves. And they care little or have any empathy for those around them. They're just about themselves and being conceited. And they don't want to be taught as well. So he says you have to be careful, these hypocritical liars, because their conscience has been seared. Their conscience has been calloused. And they're not going to respond to you or worship you. They're there for an entirely different reason. Some of the larger churches, especially those, there were cases reported in Oregon years ago. Many large churches were having issues with people from other religions, cults, whatever, coming in and trying to be part of the church, but they were looking for individuals, church members, that they could take out of the church. There was a Southern Baptist church, I think it was in Oregon, is what I'm remembering, and they found there were members of Mormons and part of the church. They were there to steal away members that were having a hard time, and they were looking for members to take away. They were literally wolves coming in to that church, looking to steal away other members. It happens. It probably happens more than you want to know. And there are a lot of people in your life that are disingenuous, that talk to you about one thing, but they're really wanting another. And that's what he talks about being the hypocrites. That they're not coming to you as talking to you. Have you ever known someone that just comes to you and all they want to talk about is business? Like they have that agenda. Or they want to talk to you about something else. They want to talk about gossip. They want to get information from you. Like they're not being genuine. We have to be careful of such because they're just using you. And we all know what it feels like to be used. And what he's saying, Timothy, is there are people that are there. There are Gnostics that are a part of your church. And you have to be careful because they're trying to draw people away from the Christian faith back into Gnosticism. Let's review what Gnosticism is for those of you that were part of the Winter Bible Study. Gnosticism is a belief that basically everything is evil that is ever created. And the only way that you get out is self-righteousness. You do good and you perform levels and you begin to get out of this evil. That sounds very appealing to someone that is powerless, that is going through a hard time. We've talked about it in here before. Everyone is looking for redemption in their life. Everyone has done something that they regret, done something that they feel terrible about. They've made wrong choices, and they feel powerless about. And the message of the gospel, as simple and as elegant and as beautiful as it is, sometimes we like to do things on our own, then let God handle it. And so Gnosticism sounds like a good investment that I can do this on my own. On my own, I can be good enough to reach heaven. Christianity says grace. Gnosticism says you have to work your way up. And that's still prevalent today. We talked about Mormonism, Jehovah's Witness. Gnosticism still comes in many forms and still appeals to many that are looking and feel helpless in this world. And I have seen there in Colombia, there are Mormon missionaries that walk the streets. There are many missionary, there are Jehovah's Witnesses that walk the streets. You don't see many Southern Baptist missionaries walk the streets. They're out to get people. They're wanting to get people. They're wanting to join, and they're selling a false message of the gospel. And it still occurs today. So he is saying be careful. Keep that in mind about Gnosticism, because that's where we get down to verse 3. They forbid people to marry and order them to abstain from certain foods which God has created and receive them with thanksgiving, those who believe and know the truth. He addressed his Gnosticism in Colossians 2:20-23. Since you have died with Christ, the elemental spiritual forces of this world. In other words, to this world you have died. To this evil world you have died. As you still belong to this world, you submit to its rules. Do not handle, do not taste, do not touch. These rules, which have things to do that are destined to perish with use, are based on merely human commands and teachings. Such regulations indeed have the appearance of wisdom with self-imposed worship. Their false humility and harsh treatment of the body, they lack the value of restraining and sensual indulgences. Gnostics were saying, don't marry because it's evil. Stay away from these foods because it's evil. Stay away from the things of this world because don't be tied to evil. You can advance. There are many things that sound wise. If you don't believe me, just go to the bookstore and look at the self-help item. Look at how many people, and you probably have a lot of friends that are on Tony Robbins, and I'm not knocking them. There's all different self-help gurus. There's a lot of knowledge going around. There's very few wisdom. And we have to guard our truth and know our wisdom because it appears like it's the solution, but it can make things worse. Everything we do should not be harsh or put down, but it should be flavored with love and grace and mercy. Not those who are, not these false teachers that are saying this should be a different way. I watched a documentary on Jehovah's Witnesses the other day, and I don't know if you know differences of people's different beliefs, but really invite you to go and study on that. Jehovah's Witness, if you are not a part of their family, Many Jehovah's Witnesses can't even have friends because they believe that there's 144,000 that's going to judge the world, and eventually they're going to be the ones, the only ones, and they have to work their way to be saved after Armageddon. That's a basic Jehovah's Witness foundation. So they cannot allow themselves to have friends that are not Jehovah's Witness because those people are going to pass away in the Armageddon. Does that make sense? Can't marry anyone that's not Jehovah's Witness. Can't have anyone in your family. If you are a Jehovah's Witness family and your child does not believe that anymore, you can have nothing to do with them. That's why they don't celebrate Christmas, holidays, because all that's evil. That's pledging allegiance and celebrating to something that's evil. Their only focus is on that Jehovah's kingdom. It's a warped view of Christianity. It's taking verses out of context, and it's making it about that you become righteous, not about grace. And that's what hardens the heart, when it becomes what you can do versus what God can do. Your heart becomes hardened in those situations. Verse 4, for everything God created is good. Exactly, he is combating what Gnosticism stands for. Gnosticism says everything is evil. Verse 4, for everything God created is good, and nothing is to be rejected if it is received with thanksgiving, because it is consecrated by the word of God and prayer. Receiving things with thanksgiving, you wouldn't, if you get somebody gave you something, food, and you thought that was evil, you wouldn't be thankful for it. But he is saying all things created by God, and we should be thankful for everything that we get. Verse 6, if you point these things out to your brothers and sisters, you will be a good minister in Christ Jesus, nourished on the truth of faith and the good teachings that you have followed. So it is our job as ministers, with positions and teachers, that we should teach to know these truths so we can combat these truths and to understand why this is so alluring to other people, so that we know how to answer their questions and be prepared to give a testimony. As ministers, we have that challenge. Verse 7, have nothing to do with the godless myth of old wives' tales. Rather, train yourself to be godly, for physical training has some value, but godliness has value for all things, holding promise for both the present life and things to come. Now, you can look at me and tell that I am not the best about physical training right now, and I'm not the one to give advice on physical training, but I do know this. When you take a walk, when you get outside, when you go and work out, it has an effect not just on your body, but it helps you mentally. It helps you in other aspects of your life. It's good to just get out. As much as I don't do it, I don't know many people that regret working out. I know a lot of people that say a lot of bad stuff before they work out, but I don't know anyone that after a workout's done, unless, you know, their body shouts at them or whatever. I don't know anyone that regrets an after a workout. And we know it has value in other parts in our life. How much more than the spiritual discipline have in our life? How much more will that spill over into our lives? If a little bit of physical workout has a great benefit of our life, mental, emotional, how much more then will spiritual? Verse 9, this is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. That's why we labor and strive, because we have put hope in the living God, the Savior of all people, especially for those who believe. Command and teach these things, and don't let anyone look down on you because you are young, but set an example for the believers in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, in purity. Every youth group that I've ever been a part of or know has claimed 1 Timothy 4:12 as kind of their group, as kind of their Bible verse in one sense or the other. Everyone loves that saying. When he says in your youth, he's talking about up to about the age of 40. So it's not just that we think Timothy's a teenager doing this. We know Timothy's been with Paul for about 15 years. So there's some experience there, at least on Timothy's part. But he's at least creeping up on 40. There's a couple of things I want to point out in verse 12. Number one, it says, don't let anyone look down on you because you're young. In the Greek, that's a present imperative. In other words, it's saying right now, don't. Right now, don't. In other words, the church is already doing that. There's already people that will say things to Timothy because of his age. It is happening now. But don't right now, Timothy, let them do that to you. They're going to look down on you because they may not understand or because of age. There's a certain respect about dignity, and we sometimes think only the older can have that. There's something to nobility, and only older generations can have that. But he's saying you can have these things because you belong to Christ. And so he says, don't let anyone look down on you because you're young, but set the example for the believers. The Greek word there literally means to make a mark, make an imprint. The same word is used when Jesus reached out his hand and Thomas touched the scars. The scars were an imprint. Make that imprint to them. Make something that they would have definitive proof about your calling as a minister. That is why we are called, for those that are called into the ministry, to live above reproach in everything that we do, the challenge in what we do. Because if my life does not match my message, then coming up to the pulpit, it empties out the message when I get up here. As teachers of God's word, if your life does not reflect what you teach and the values that you teach, it empties out that message. Whatever it is, and title that you have, whether it's deacon, whether it's WMU, whatever it is within the church, just as Christians in general, if we claim God's hope and we are Christ's followers, then our life should set an example to that. We should make a mark when someone, they should look at us and say there is something completely different about them. We should make that mark among everyone else. Something that should be so radically different about us. As ministers, there's a higher calling that you should stand out even among those believers. You should make that impression even among those who call themselves Christ followers. And he says you should answer them back in this way. Set an example in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, and purity. He says to set an example in love. We know, for those of you that have been to church long enough, that the type of love that God has for us is agape love. It's a love without condition. It is a will to love. In other words, that it's easy to love someone that likes you back. It's easy to love someone that loves you. It's hard to love someone that hates you. It's hard to love someone that rejects you. You have to will yourself to love them. You have to push beyond what you can do. And yes, sometimes that is a love that only God can do for you. But it is a love without condition. When I say on Sunday mornings and Sunday nights, when I stand up here and say, I love you and there's nothing you can do about it, I'm saying that coming out of 1 Timothy 4:12, I'm showing you that in love, I love you like agape love. I love you as God loves you, and there's nothing you can do about it. You can hate me, I will still love you. You can reject me, you can put me down, whatever it is, I will still love you because that's my calling as a minister. Reading that in verse 4:12, that is our calling as ministers. We are to love even if you hate and reject us. We're going to love because Christ loved us in the same way. So that's why I've adopted that saying, because that's what we're supposed to do there as pastors. Another thing I want to point out that we've been talking about in the last couple of weeks, he said that you should set an example in purity. For those of you that have been there, here's the testament. What is the temple that was in Ephesus that's one of the seven wonders of the ancient world? Anybody remember the temple of? Temple of Artemis and Diana. You all fail the test. The temple, remember, there was the temple of Diana, the temple of Artemis. held about 24,000, surrounded in pillars at this time. She was the goddess of fertility. And like I said, during these times, there were worship services where people worshiped the god of fertility. Paul is using the Greek word there, impurity, and sexually abstaining, because he's calling out, Timothy, remember where you are. Stay away from everything. Set the example in sexual purity. Because you live in Ephesus, where there's that big bad temple and a lot of stuff going on at that temple. You be different than everyone else that's there. You set the example in purity. I'm just going to drop down to verse 15. Be diligent in these matters. Give yourself wholly to them so that everyone may see your progress. Watch your life and doctrine closely. Persevere in them, because if you do, you will save both yourself and your hearers. There's a call to accountability as a minister. There's a call that we should have others look at us and what we do. Being in the ministry, one of the hardest things to get used to is what's called living in the glass bowl. In other words, that everyone could come by and see your life. Especially when we lived here at the parsonage, people would come by and drive by and see and make comments, whatever. And that's just a part of ministry. And it's not a fun part of ministry to do that. But we are held accountable and we're called to a higher calling. And that's hard. And that's hard sometimes when you're always held accountable or people are holding you to one thing and then something else comes. That's hard because we're human. We want to break, or we want to say, look at you, or we want to put something else on, but we have to be humble in that calling. Tonight, as we're here, I want to challenge you, going back to verse 12. Don't let anyone look down upon you because you are, because tonight you are here in God's house. You are worshiping God, and don't let anyone look down on you by the way you worship God. Not just in here, but as you depart from this place and as you go and worship in the community. I hope that your worship leaves an imprint on those around you. That whatever you do, they say there is something different about that person. But you can't do that if you're worried about what everyone else is going to say. So tonight, the altar is going to be open. If you need to come down and there's something that you have placed in front of God, the altar is going to be open, then you can come down. But tonight, as always, the altar is open. If you don't know Christ Jesus as your Savior, please don't leave here tonight. I realize that Sunday nights are a lot of people that have been in church for a long time, but sometimes there can be people in that are deceived, and they know there's something not right in their life. We sit here and talk about what it is to live a godly life, and week after week they say, my life isn't like that. I don't want to study the Bible. I struggle to pray. I'm not even sure if I am saved or not. Don't leave tonight with salvation in doubt, because it's too important. Whatever it is that you need to do tonight, the altar will be open. But don't let anyone look down upon you for what you do. You just be faithful to God's calling. Let's pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, I thank you for those that have come tonight. God, you challenged Timothy and his life to leave an imprint among those around you, around him. God, I pray if there's anyone here tonight that has been struggling their relationship with you, may they come to the altar tonight, Lord God, to leave down their hurt, to leave down their possessions, to leave down their idols tonight at the altar. Because you have called us for a higher living, and we cannot do that holding on to the dirt and to the pain. So may we put down our possessions at the altar tonight and lift our hands in worship this week to you. God, I pray if there's someone here that does not know you, they would not leave this place with that doubt ever in mind. Whatever it is you are calling us tonight to do, may we be receptive to your message, because it can change everything. In your name we pray, amen.
Where he leads me, I will go. 436, would you stand, please? I can hear my Savior calling. I can hear my Savior calling. Savior calling. I can hear my Savior calling. Take thy cross and follow me. Where he leads me, I will follow. Where he leads me, I will follow. Where he leads me, I will follow. I'll go with him
Thank you for coming tonight, and thank you for being part of this worship service and part of the walk through Timothy. I hope we get to continue on this later down the road, but reminder, this is my last week to be preaching for a while. Dr. Pace will be coming next week from the Baptist building in Jackson and will be leading us with a sermon, and so we look forward to that. Like I said tonight, there is many exciting things going on in our church, and I know it's been a struggle, but we are going to come back better than ever, and we're going to come back united, and it's going to be a great year for Bunker Hill Baptist Church because we serve a great God. Thank you for all being a part of this. Know I love you. There's nothing you can do about that to change that. Come by the office this week if you need to talk. Have a great week. Show an example to others. Brother Tom Spites, if you pray for us tonight.